Hello and welcome to Theater of Guts and Company. I'm Skunk Ape, and with me today is Eric Hellhammer.
Hey, how you doing?
That's right. Say hi to the nice people.
Okay.
So anyway, this is episode one. We're both part of theaterofguts.com, and today's episode is called Last Hess on the Edge of the Park. That's right. We're going to be talking all about House on the Edge of the Park with our favorite film stars, David A. Hess and John Morgan. So, Eric, what are you doing right now? Are you drinking anything?
No, it's too early. I'm just having some coffee, breakfast.
Yes, we're all hopped up on coffee. Usually we talk about these films at night so we can enjoy beer and get silly, but our schedules just don't allow it anymore. So we're here in the morning, drinking lots of coffee, ready to talk about House on the Edge of the Park.
Yeah.
So first off, I love this movie. We also quickly want to mention that we don't condone rape by any means.
Nope.
No, not at all. It's just a small part of the exploitation films we love. And, you know, if the rapist doesn't get what he deserves by the end of the film, then I don't like it.
You know, I saw this on the video shelf at Blockbuster, and I really liked the cover, but I never rented it. A lot of films you would rent and, you know, get me to see. Because, actually, I saw this the first time with you.
It's funny that you mentioned Blockbuster, because that's actually where I rented it from.
Yeah.
Because they're so wholesome, and I remember The Undertaker and their pals had the youth-restricted symbol on it, but yet House at the Edge of the Park was fair game for anyone. And it was like the first time like I recognized Ruggiero Deodato's name on the actual box after seeing a lot of his films.
Did you see Cannibal Holocaust beforehand?
Yeah, I saw it before this.
Oh, okay.
But usually, you know how like Fulci was, what was his fake name?
Lewis Fuller.
Yeah, Lewis Fuller. I was about to say Lewis Coates, but that's Cozy on Contamination.
Luigi.
So it was rare to ever see like an Italian's real name on a VHS box, but House on the Edge of the Park actually had Ruggiero Deodato's name on it, and that's why I instantly rented it from Blockbuster.
Oh, okay. And I saw Last House on the Left, like, you know, a couple years before.
So you were ready for another good house movie.
Yeah, but I had no idea he was in it. I probably would have checked it out because I don't know. I just really like David Hess. He's like the best part of. I mean, it's kind of an ensemble, but he's just really terrifying, you know. And I would watch anything else that guy was in at the time.
I mean, it starts out with a huge rape. He's driving along, unsuspecting woman. And then he rapes her, and then the movie just starts.
Right.
So what are some of the things that you like about this film?
Well, I love John Morgan, too. You know, I can't remember. I think I saw Cannibal Ferox before I saw him in this. And I just didn't put it together. And I probably saw Gates of Hell, too. I think I saw everything before I saw this one. It took me a while. I don't know. I think I was just afraid of the Deodato name.
Right. It's kind of funny. Like, it's like you mentioned, like, you didn't know David Hess was in it. And, you know, I didn't even bother to read who else was in the credits.
Yeah.
And then just putting the VHS in and seeing Hess in the movie was like a huge surprise.
Right, as a bonus.
Yeah. Meanwhile, I could have just read the back of the box. But then it's like David Hess wasn't really a household name to me the way he is now.
Yeah. Well, I was just really impressed by Last House on the Left. I just kept thinking about that guy.
Right. When's he going to show up in other movies?
Yeah.
And he did, but we'll get to that a little bit later. So, yeah, so David Hess and John Morgan. So we said David Hess starts right off. He rapes a woman in a car. He strangles while he rapes her, so she perishes. Cut to the credits. And then they're in a parking garage. And that's when the infamous line pops up where John Morgan asks him if they're going to boogie.
Yeah, there's this whole concept of, like, fun and games where, You know, their idea of fun is raping people and being sleazy and terrorizing people. And they're like all keyed up, you know, like, I
Right.
can't wait, you know, to fuck with these people and ruin their lives. They're like total maniacs, but they're really into it, you know, it's so creepy.
So I gotta say, like on the IMDb, like in the description, it says two low life punks invite themselves to a party.
Yeah.
Do they really invite themselves, or did they invite them?
Yeah, right. Yeah, because they didn't just crash some random house, did they?
Right, and we're gonna totally spoil the twist at the end, so.
Yeah, you might want to watch it before.
Right, because if they invited themselves, how would that correlate with their plan to lure them to the party?
Yeah, right. It's like a setup, you know?
That's why you just can't trust IMDb, and you still have to listen to amazing broadcasts such as these to get real information. So we often compare Hess and Morgan to the two wild and crazy guys.
Yeah.
And I do believe that that came out in 77. So it is possible that Deodato could have seen The Wild and Crazy Guys and said, you know, that's my next movie.
Yeah,
Except
let's make it rapists.
they're really gonna get wild.
Yeah,
And you know what? I never knew because I was kind of like looking up on the internet the Wild and Crazy Guys just to see if there was any information. And they're called the Festrunk Brothers.
they're like supposed to be these, kind of stereotypes, bad stereotypes of foreign party guys.
But did you know they were called the Festrunk Brothers?
I had no idea. Yeah, if somebody said to you, "Hey, you know, the Festrunk brothers," you'd be like, "Oh, what?"
Okay, so obviously we love the chemistry between Hess and Morgan and the way they get invited to this party. You know, they cause mayhem. You know, everybody says that this is, you know, basically a ripoff of Last House on the Left, but there's actually quite a bit of differences, and we're gonna just kind of brainstorm some of those. First of all, it's kind of funny that the original Last House on the Left came out in 1972, and this movie came out in 1980. So that's a long time for someone to be like, oh, maybe we should rip off Last House on the Left
Yeah.
8 years later.
Right.
I mean, the only thing that really kind of connects them is the word house, rape, and David Hess. You know, Last House on the Left, as you know, many of you know, is basically just a remake of Bergman's The Virgin Spring, but a super sleazy version of it.
Yeah.
You know, House is kind of like a whole nother beast on its own with an amazingly bad twist, and it's just kind of a bunch of different set pieces strung together.
Yeah, when you think about it, it could be like a Krug sequel, you know, where Krug just found a new buddy. But then again, he died. And
Well, then again, Ilsa died at the end of She-Wolf of the SS, and that didn't stop her
so,
from.
yeah, right. Two more sequels, or three more.
Right, so good point. This is kind of the bastard sequel. What would Krug do if he had one more chance? Yeah, and he had three sidekicks in Last House on the Left to deal with. You know, he had Weasel, his son Junkie, and Sadie, the female character.
Yeah,
And
and
as
oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, as I say those characters' names, you almost kind of want to burst out in song. Weasel?
Yeah, ragtime. Yeah, and I don't know, I would say that that's more of an ensemble. Like Weasel, he's just as terrifying as Krug. And
Right.
they describe Sadie as like a feral woman, you know, kind of like a Manson family type.
Right.
But yeah, they're more like equals, I would say. The only weak character is the son.
Right, because Hess controls him with heroin.
Yeah, I don't know. He only gets like weaker towards the end where he tells him to blow his brains out. I like how he's yelling at him. No, I won't do it.
He almost triumphed.
Yeah.
But in the end, you just don't mess with Hess.
Right.
Do what he says, or
Put the gun in your mouth.
Junior is the weakest. Hess controls him. So that's really the only similarity to John Morgan's character in House on the Edge is that Hess basically controls him due to the fact that he's slow and dim-witted.
Right.
Yeah, you wanted to say something about his on-screen relationship with Lorraine Dessel.
Yeah, that's the, like that was the weirdest scene. It was so offensive how he rapes her and then he starts crying, and then she feels sorry for him.
Right.
And then it's like a bond, like all of a sudden they're a couple. Like it doesn't make any logical sense. And
Well,
this, yeah,
for
I'll say.
sorry, first Hess wanted him to rape her in front of everybody, but he couldn't do it.
Oh, right, yeah.
So she saw that he had a sensitive side.
Yeah, right. So disgusting.
But it's weird too, because like you said, he chases her out, and then he jumps on top of her. But is he really raping her? Because she's not struggling.
Yeah.
And they're playing, of course, the romantic sweetly, oh sweetly.
That's a good one.
And then they kind of become buddies, go back to the house, and then Morgan tries to pull a fast one on Hess, saying, "Oh, okay, we've had our fun, let's get out of here." But Hess, he's not over. He's still got lots of good ideas.
He still hasn't busted out the straight razor.
So yeah, so you brought up Night Train Murders a little while back. That was like the immediate response to Last House on the Left because that came out about 2 years later. Director Aldo Lado, I believe. And that was basically a Last House on the Left complete ripoff, but on a train.
Yeah, I mean, that's how it goes in Italy, right? As soon as something comes out, they just want to capitalize on it and then make it weirder and more demented.
Right. But in that one, they didn't have the junior character. They had the kind of weird woman and two dudes.
Yeah, the lady from Deep Red and
That spits out the water. But yeah, we were kind of just goofing around. Like, we noticed that a lot of these. Well, ever since Last House. No, actually, before. Anyway, let me just spit it out. We were talking about Hess's afro, and like we were wondering if it was like a coincidence that there's a character called Curly in Night Train Murders, also known as Last Stop on the Night Train, has an afro, and the very fact that his name's Curly because he has curly hair, would you think that was a direct attempt to, I don't know, to say that the afro was a symbol of rape?
I wouldn't go that far.
Well, not, well, go ahead.
Well, yeah, I mean, they have like a Hess-like character with the look. Yeah, I guess that's what they were going for. It reminds me of the guy in the incident, Tony Masante. He's kind of a Hess-like dude with a afro and big sideburns.
That's right, and Martin Sheen is the John Morgan.
Yeah, and they're both on a train. But I don't know if there's a connection. I guess you could go there if you wanted, but
But they never raped anybody.
no, I mean it seemed like it was bordering on that, but it was like 1960 something, so
Right. And it had like a good cast of actors too, so it's not like you're gonna get Ed McMahon, who was one of the passengers to agree to having his daughter raped in front of him or something.
It was in the 70s, I feel like it could have gone there.
Although, if he was the one that got raped, that would probably be my favorite of all these films.
Yeah, me too.
But when you put together the incident, Last House on the Left, House on the Edge, and Night Train Murders, they all have similar features. They're
Yeah.
all kind of like little bits and pieces of each other.
Right.
And you just gotta wonder, like, did one director see another film and decide, like, oh, well, we want to rip off Last House on the Left, and I love the incident, so let's move it to a train.
Right.
Or was it just a mere coincidence?
Let's get it mobile.
Right.
Mobile rate machine.
Yeah, I gotta say though, what is your favorite intense scene from House on the Edge of the Park? I know mine is the razor blade scene where out of nowhere somebody knocks on the door. It's little Cindy.
Yeah, that's like your favorite
It's
scene.
not my favorite
Can't
scene.
believe that.
It's horrifying. It's like the scene that never loses its ability. No matter how many times I watch the film,
Right.
there's always like a cringe or like, oh, how could he do that? He makes this poor girl strip down and, you think he's gonna do what he normally does, but he just cuts her with a razor blade.
It's like she's bait or something. Yeah, it's weird because they just let her in and then, hey, here's this dude. She seems impressed by him. Like, oh, who's this guy?
Yeah, who's this stud?
And no one's like saying anything like, hey, maybe let's call her and tell her not to come over that day. It's almost like intentional, like they're responsible for her.
Just for letting her in, not
Yeah.
telling her to run like hell.
It's not like she just crashed the party. She knew these people. And they were like, hey, come on over. We're having a party.
Well, yeah, at no point did they ever think maybe to like try to call her and tell her not to come.
Yeah, help her out or something.
Me and Eric did an interview with Mr. John Morgan. He's a very lovely man. We have to say you can look it up on YouTube, Theater of Guts, John Morgan interview. And that's how we single-handedly know that Christian Borrimo disappeared because he was giving us information on what happened to the rest of the characters.
Yeah, he would know.
All right, so I wanted to get back to the music real quick of House on the Edge of the Park, because I feel that's another reason why I love the film and a lot of people love the film. John Morgan's silly dance scene over a song called Much More. As we said earlier, there's a song called Sweetly, Oh Sweetly. Plays from the beginning of the film, throughout the film, and the end of the film. And there's one other song that was always a mystery song to me. When we finally found out what it was.
Yeah, I remember you even asked John Morgan about it, didn't you?
Right, and he had no clue what I was talking about.
Yeah.
Because he's like, oh, Sweetly, Oh Sweetly, Much More. And I was like, no, I'm like, there's one more. And finally, we found it. It's called Give Me a Chance. And it's from a movie called First Love.
It's so weird.
Right. And Riz Ortolani did all three tracks for the film. I think Sweetly may have been the only song he did for this actual movie. Because Much More is featured on another soundtrack called Ghost Love.
Really?
Yeah, and it's in Italian it's Fantasma de Amore.
Ooh, nice.
So, but yeah, Much More and Give Me a Chance are two musical pieces that Riz composed and performed by a trio known as Charlie, Rosa, and Pat.
Another Oliver Onions.
Yeah. So those three, I wish they did more stuff because they're pretty awesome. You're a fan of the soundtrack, right?
Oh yeah, I love it. Yeah,
Yeah.
you know that song gets a little monotonous, but no, it's great. It fits. I don't know what it is about the disco; it just really fits. But yeah, it reminds me of how the Psycho and Don't Go in the House is all in a disco too.
Right. Is there a connection between disco and sleaze, but or is it just that was the popular music at the time of the 70s?
Yeah, it was just a 70s thing, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, because sometimes I like, well, it just depends on the movie, because sometimes it's cool when you have like one or two songs that just play the entire movie.
Yeah.
And then it just comes like a part of that film, as opposed to like a traditional soundtrack where it's just creating mood behind every scene, and you don't even really notice what's happening because the soundtrack kind of just blends into the film.
Yeah.
And then you don't really remember the soundtrack. But in House on the Edge, you'll never forget at least two of the songs. I never forgot all three, but apparently John Morgan forgot one, so we'll say you'll never forget two out of the three of the songs.
Yeah, we should probably mention that Demi Roos of Aphrodite's Child song for Night Train Murders, the All You Need Is a Flower.
Right. And that song, I believe, plays at the beginning and the end only. It kind of bookmarks it. Is that true?
Yeah, that is, man, that voice. I like that band a lot, but that's the first time I heard that guy, you know? I wasn't into the band Aphrodite's Child, but
Right, that's right. You told me. You're like, oh, you'll never believe that the guy that sings the flower song actually has a band. And the band is Aphrodite's Child. So if anybody loves that high voice, look them up. And another fun fact is, Mr. Vangelis himself
Yeah, he
was
was in there, yeah.
Chariots of Fire, dude.
Blade Runner.
And if you ever see his last name, you'll know why he did his solo work as just Vangelis. It's like Papa Thanasuya.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, and we lost Demise this year
Yeah.
in January 2015. So there'll be no more flower songs. And then of course the music from Last House on the Left is key because that divides a lot of fans.
Yeah, it really does. You know, people get in heated arguments over it. You know, they hate the ragtime,
Right.
that kind of takes you out of the film. You know, and I guess it like douses the tension a little with the, you know.
Right, but it also at the same time, it's like, what are they trying to do? They're trying to make it sound like this is a fun, loving, good time
Yeah,
that
right.
we should all try.
It's just weird because the guy who's doing all the killing and raping, he's like encouraging all this behavior with the
Right.
soundtrack.
I know that he was booked to do the soundtrack before the acting, but I wonder if he finished the soundtrack before Wes Craven asked him to actually act in the film.
Yeah, I don't know.
But yeah, that's an amazing soundtrack. The House on the Edge of the Park soundtrack's never been released. I mean, mainly because it's only three tracks, so Sweetly's only available through, bootleg fan versions. But much more Give Me a Chance. If you can find the Ghost Love soundtrack or First Love soundtrack, you can get a good quality version of those tracks.
And then there's that Great Island Rocks cover.
Oh yeah.
That guy's really talented.
Amazing stuff. If you're looking for fan music, just pop on over to YouTube and look up Island Rocks, one word. And you'll find all kinds of great tributes to songs. Everything from House on the Edge to House by the Cemetery, Cannibal Holocaust.
A lot of different zombie covers. It gets pretty crazy with those. It's
Right.
like a ska one, a disco one,
Right.
over the place.
Not to mention some kick-ass post-apocalyptic thrillers
Yeah.
style tributes. So what are some other of your favorite revenge or rape revenge films that are just not influenced by Last House on the Left?
Well, I got my top five right here. Are yours as similar as mine, or I didn't see yours?
I know, because I didn't want you to copy them.
Okay. Well, I don't know. It was a toss up between. I love Savage Streets. That's probably my all time favorite. But then I thought about it, and Ms. 45. I used to call it MS 45, and you always make fun of me.
I
But.
think make fun of you is harsh. I would say probably just correct you and snicker
Yeah.
as if to say, why do you keep doing this on a weekly basis?
I actually saw that in Terror in the Isles, and that was probably the first rape revenge movie I fell in love with, and the career of Abel Ferrara.
Right.
So yeah, that's my number one favorite. And I just saw it in the theater recently during the day. I don't know why I kept doing that. It's like I love going to the theater during the day. There isn't a big crowd at the Roxy in San Francisco, and there was probably like 10 people there. And one guy was like, "Hey, I saw this in the 70s when it came out, or the 80s." And actually, it came out in the 80s, and I was like, "Really? Like, I can't believe it." He was excited to see it again.
Well, yeah, who wouldn't be?
But people were really quiet, there's no reaction. It was really uncomfortable. But I love that one. It's just so fun. It's really warped and demented and a really good time capsule of gritty New York at the,
Right. What's your take on the dog? With that
Oh, where she feeds them the parts.
she hitches him out to yeah, and then hitches him out to
Oh
the
no, he doesn't eat anybody. No, she just leaves them out right by the docks.
Right.
Yeah. Was he a male or female dog? It seems like he hated all men.
See? Those
Yeah.
are the tough questions that we hope to get answers to.
Right. I didn't think about that. I just thought, she's psychotic and
Right. Well,
cool.
I'm gonna let out a little spoiler, not to interrupt, but Miss 45 is on my list.
Oh,
But I just wanted to mention while you were talking about it that I really hated that landlord lady and her dog. So I was kind of hoping she would get killed.
yeah, but very realistic.
Yeah.
I
That's
don't think she was an actor. She just was probably there or something.
yeah. Probably own the building, and she's like, "I'm not gonna let you use it unless you put me in this movie."
Yeah, I can totally see
You know
that.
what? And I think I watched the bonus features, and Abel explained it, but I just kind of forgot.
Yeah, he really rambles on those commentaries. They're really fun to listen to, but they're so bizarre. Like for the driller killer, seemed like he was really stoned. He was just
Well,
nuts.
he's a time capsule.
Yeah,
He
really.
still uses the word like dig and
Yeah, he's like old beatnik.
So what's number two?
Mine is Savage Streets.
That's a good one.
Yeah, I've been waiting for that one to come out forever. I saw it in Fangoria with the this Exorcist interview, and I was like, "Oh, what's that?" Some 80s thing with Linda Blair and a crossbow and Linnea Quigley. Think that's her
Right.
first film. And then
And
pre-breast implants. And yeah, there's just so much going on. I love the psychos. They're all these beefy dudes that are always cackling, as they're throwing people off of bridges, and they're just having a good time. Always laughing. I don't, it's so demented how they're always having a good time, enjoying their work.
Is it though?
Yeah, guess it's really accurate, but
We should mention that this one is different in the fact that Linda Blair doesn't get raped. She's out for vengeance for her. Is it her sister or her
yeah,
friend?
it's her sister who's like a mute or no, she's just deaf.
Deaf.
But yeah, it's right. She's like a powerhouse. She just takes everybody down, and there's a Matthew style character. You know, there's like one weak dude that she kind of overpowers. You know, and doesn't want to be a rapist. You know, with his buddies.
He wants out.
And they kind of poke fun at him. And yeah, I love the Hollywood Boulevard sleaze and just all these hot girls. And it's just so much going for it. It's got so much going for it. Yeah, Linda Blair was really attractive at the time. It's, you know, and I don't want to spoil the ending or anything, but yeah, it's the ending's a little weird. Like, I feel like she could have gone overboard with. She lights this one guy on fire, but I feel like
Right.
they deserved worse because the rape is really vicious.
Well, that's the thing about movies is that when somebody gets lit on fire, you kind of feel like, well, maybe they didn't suffer enough, but they probably did because fire really hurts. It's probably like one of the worst things ever that could happen to you.
Yeah, it's like you're just a big turkey getting cooked, roasting in your own juices.
Because I remember that was my biggest problem. You told me to watch Vigilante, and
Well, French vigilante.
yeah, and I'm like, okay, well, these guys killed this guy's entire family, or they killed his daughter, and his wife went crazy, and then Robert Forster chases one of the thugs up and then just pushes him off the ledge. I'm like, that's no good.
Yeah. Well, I'm so glad I introduced you to Vigilante.
Well, I am still glad too.
I mean, I don't consider that a rape revenge, even though it is.
Right, I don't consider it a rape revenge either. I just kind of I brought it up because you were saying like when the justice it when okay, when somebody goes through a tragedy and then they get revenge and then you don't feel like they suffered enough. That's kind of how I felt when I was
Oh, cool.
watching that.
Yeah.
Rolling Thunder, I felt the same way too.
Okay. I'm trying to remember the finale of Rome. All I can think about is Tommy Lee Jones and William Devane, you know, shooting up the hooker hotel.
Exactly. They were just shooting it up.
Okay.
They needed to extract the cause of the situation and slowly dissect them, make them into a human centipede with all the other thugs that put his hand in a garbage disposal and killed his wife and kid. All for like what? He what? Like a commemorative, like a copper set of pennies? Which is like the
Yeah,
most
that was like a
ridiculous thing
big deal
ever.
back then.
Yeah.
They really had to get that suitcase.
Right. A Vietnam hero wins like a commemorative set of presidential 50-cent pieces. And then they could have just robbed a bank or something, you know?
Yeah,
This
anything.
bitch. But anyway, so what's number three?
Yeah, what was your two?
All right, well, I was gonna go. All right, well, all right. House on the Edge is my number one.
All right, of course.
So, what else can I say about that? I think we covered everything. It's just the Hess factor all the way.
Yeah.
Morgan, just being a fan of all those Italian movies.
And I didn't put that on my list because, you know, I figured we were gonna talk overboard about it.
Actually, you know what? We are going to go overboard about it. I mean,
Really?
yes.
Okay, sure.
Because we didn't even mention my favorite part, and that's when Hess gets shot in the balls.
Yeah, we gotta mention that.
Right. So This guy, he's standing by the pool. They're finally gonna get their revenge. They shoot him right in the dick, and the most amazing thing happens. He screams. We should have timed it out. But anyway, that's your mission. Time it out and then leave it in the comment section. 'Cause literally this guy's screaming for, what do you think? Let's guess. 15 seconds?
15 minutes.
15 minutes in slow motion.
It seems like an hour. It's a really long scream.
So after Hess has destroyed everybody's will, humiliated everybody, he gets shot in the balls and he screams for 15 minutes. No, more like 15 seconds. And then he falls in the pool.
Yeah, that was crazy. That's a moment you just keep rewinding over and over again. You can't believe it.
Right, and we still haven't fully ruined the twist, because we were kind of saying earlier, like, okay, well, if it was their was it their idea to go to the party, did they invite themselves or were they lured into it? But it turns out that what was the woman that he raped in the beginning of the movie was the sister of one of the people in the house.
That's right.
So they invite him in, party with him, and then at some point they were planning on killing him and pinning him as burglars, which makes no fucking sense.
No.
They should have maybe had a gun closer in their pocket, maybe at some point.
Yeah, I just like how they went through all that torture, humiliation. The dude from Murder Rockets, his face bashed in like a million times, and then he's like, "Yeah, it was a setup. I planned all this."
Right. They didn't plan shit, 'cause if you were gonna, why would you play poker with a couple of dudes you were gonna kill?
Yeah, keep your enemies closer.
So number two is Last House on the Left, surprise.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
For all the reason we discussed it, it's you watch it and you're kind of in shock. You just don't know how to feel emotionally because you're watching all this shocking stuff and you're listening to banjo music. I had no idea what to expect, and the final result was mind-blowing.
I probably saw that right after Texas Chainsaw. But I know I saw Nightmare on Elm Street first, and then I probably saw Chainsaw and then Last House.
Right.
It's hard to remember.
so when you saw it, you were like, oh, I gotta go see Wes Craven's first film, or it was just like, I just, yeah.
I had to see whatever, because this guy was at Fangoria all the time, and I'm like, Last House on the Left, I gotta see that now.
Right. That's why I saw it too. I was like, oh, what's this Last House movie? I was like, well, I gotta see what Wes Craven's first movie's all about.
Yeah, right. He was such a big deal. I mean,
Right. And I had no idea, Sean Cunningham was the producer.
yeah, all those
And
guys.
it's weird to think that Cunningham brought Friday the 13th and Jason to the big screen, and Wes brought Freddy, the two biggest
Slasher guys.
horror guys, split from one horrible film.
Right.
Horribly good film.
Yeah.
And I'm sure everybody knows that's why Freddy Krueger is, Krug from Last House puts the Krug in Krueger.
I read something funny on IMDb. You know how some of it's bullshit? It'll just appear one day. They add all this new info. It said that Wes Craven, some bully was named Fred Krueger. And then he saw a homeless guy who had a red and green sweater. Made an impression on him.
Did you say you're number three?
No.
All right, we'll get back to your number three.
Okay.
What's your number three?
Oh, sorry. It's the Ladies Club.
Ladies Club.
Yeah. And I got a video from Chaz Ballin that had a trailer on there.
And I'm so glad you did, because this movie is way off the radar.
Yeah. Still not released. It's a total shame. I don't understand. It's got star power too. It's got Ricky Stratton's mom from Silver Spoons and that really pretty actress from Mommy Dearest. What the hell's her name? Rumblefish.
No, I can't think of it.
I'm gonna go look
All
it up.
right. While you do that, I'm going to say my number three, which is what you already mentioned, Miss 45.
Okay, number three. And when did you first see that one?
It that was big box appeal. I was already out of high school.
Right.
And again, it was name recommend. Again, it was name recognition. I saw Abel's name on the big ass box, Miss 45. It was about the time Bad Lieutenant came out,
Oh, really? Okay.
because that was like the first exposure I had to that guy, and I just loved that movie so much.
Yeah.
Like, I went out and I tried to find whatever he did. I think I saw King of New York right after Bad Lieutenant, and then while browsing through used videos, I got Miss 45 for $10 in the big box, and like I had no expectations because I was like, what is this?
Yeah.
And it was just like amazing.
Well, all the clips from Terror in the Isles, that was really shocking. That movie really helped me find a lot of other films like Vice Squad and Nighthawks. I never would have known about those. And those aren't horror films, it's definitely exploitation, but
Right, and Terror of the Isles, for anyone that doesn't know, is less like basically Donald Pleasance
Nancy Allen.
and Nancy Allen in a movie theater talking about horror films and then exposing us to different clips, from everything from like Halloween, Jaws,
Exorcist.
yeah, and the ones you just mentioned.
Yeah, some obscure shit that you're
Right.
like, whoa, yeah, I gotta see that too.
Which may have just been there because that was the only thing they had the rights to.
Yeah, who knows? It was a really good compilation. It's weird. A lot of people have problems with that movie. I know the Psychotronic guy kind of makes fun of it. He's like, who are these guys telling me what to watch? It's weird. So I don't know.
I trust Donald Pleasance.
Yeah. Right, Puma Man.
Right.
Okay, well, yeah, let's. Okay, I found her name, Diana Scarwid. She's in the Ladies Club. And yeah, she's great in that.
Right, and Ladies Club takes a different approach. They don't go out and just blow people's brains out. They
No.
kind of just they figure out who they need to catch, they knock them out, and then they have a doctor in the group and they castrate them surgically and they set them free.
Yeah, it's a gaggle of professionals that are all
Right.
different things they bring to the table, like castration, yeah, to dupe these guys, get them, lure them in with different women, and torture them. Nicholas Worth is one of the guys that gets fucked over.
Nicholas, don't answer the phone, Worth.
Yeah, Dark Man and all kinds of stuff. Yeah, it's a crime that one isn't on DVD. It's great. I don't understand.
All right, what's your number four?
Okay, four is Naked Vengeance.
Which is another underrated classic.
Yeah, I would have never discovered this one had it not been for justforthehellofit.com. Really great DVD company. I first discovered them through Psychotronic. For a while it was all just for the hell of it titles that he would review. And, yeah, and they're still going strong as, no one really buys DVDs now. It's kind of sad, but this guy really unearths a lot of crazy shit.
Right.
and puts them on a double feature. You know, they're a little pricey, $30, but I support this guy, and, you know, I feel like you need these people because we're getting to a point where there's no film critics anymore. There's nobody recommending anything, just selling you, you know, the same trash.
And, right.
Yeah, we need these guys to, you know, for film fans to discover, and, you know, they're a dying breed.
Right. So that title is Naked Vengeance. That's a double recommendation for sure.
Oh, is that on your countdown?
No.
Okay.
I tricked you. I said it was going to be, but... now, my number four is Lipstick.
Oh, yeah. You introduced me to Lipstick.
This...
That was a challenge, remember? That was one of our film challenges.
It was. Yeah. But I knew it wasn't going to be much of a challenge for you to watch, because...
Well, it's hard to take, that's for sure.
It is true. It's such a sleazy movie, but, again, it's one of those ones where the cast, like, you know everybody. It's got David Sarandon is the rapist. Chris Sarandon.
Yeah, from Fright Night.
Or, as many know, Prince Humperdinck.
All right. Spry.
So he's a struggling musician, and that to me is the most appeal of the film, is that the music this guy makes is so batshit crazy,
yeah,
and terrible, that it just adds like a whole nother part of the film that you'll never get from any other film. And it has the Hemingway sisters, and, you know, one of them falls victim. You know, so it's about the other sister getting revenge for her sister, you know, using herself to try to lure him in, you know, but he always kind of seems to be one step ahead of her. But it's one of those films that makes you really angry, too, because it has one of those absurd courtroom drama scenes.
Yeah.
Where it's like they have all the evidence they would ever need to put this guy away.
Yeah.
But then... You know, the sleazy lawyer's like, well, she was wearing a short skirt that day trying to tease him. And then it's like, oh, well, then it's her fault. And then you just let him walk free. So it kind of like, it knows how to pull your strings and you get pissed off. But
yeah,
in the end, it all works out. I mean, I don't think he gets his just desserts, but that weird music that he makes, that it makes it all worthwhile.
Yeah, I love how he plays it over the phone. He prank calls her late at night, and yeah, that's a pretty vicious rape. And poor little, what's her name, Mariel Hemingway. He rapes her too. It's, you know, the little kid. It's like one of her first films, and. Yeah, that part is so revolting. And she kind of falls for him, like, oh, he's so charming. How does that happen, you know?
Yeah, you don't know really what to think.
Yeah, I love that. I love that one song, too, though. Besides his music's pretty bad, but I like the theme. The kind of weird goblin-esque, like...
Yeah, it's really good. And this movie did get a DVD release, a legit one, but it's, you know, one of those ones they were embarrassed about. So it's like it doesn't even have a trailer. It's just,
yeah, that's kind of sad.
Just push play. But you never know. Maybe soon.
Yeah, hopefully.
Because, you know, I'd like to hear some thoughts. Like, what the hell were you thinking when you made this?
And surprise, that is actually on my countdown too, for number five.
Lipstick number five.
I wanted to put it up higher, but I just had other titles I liked. I'd say not that I didn't like them anymore, but you know how it is with the top five.
Right. Yeah, I kind of went by the, because Lipstick, it's kind of hard to watch repeated viewings of, because, you know, you feel so dirty.
Yeah.
It's so hateful, but yet so good. So it might have been a little higher.
That has like an incredible ending.
Right.
Last 10 minutes are insanely good.
Right.
Yeah.
But like House on the Edge I can put on any time, you know, it's kind of like it's kind, I mean, if it came on like TBS at like
You're
one of
sick.
I Well, you know, it's like usually like when Goodfellas is on AMC or you just leave it on.
Yeah, I think I have that attachment with Amityville 2 that you have with last the House on the Edge.
Yeah, but it's like an imaginary, like nobody's ever gonna play it. So you're never gonna like just turn on the TV and leave it on.
Yeah, but I just love what that film does to me because it's so disturbing, it's so sleazy, and it's scary.
It's horrible.
Yeah, but I
But
don't know why I like want to watch it over and over again. It's so crazy.
it, you know what it, I think it's just so hard to believe that the first one is just such, it's just such a mainstream title and everybody knows the Amityville Horror.
Yeah.
And then just the way the second one came out, it's like it's not made for mass consumption. It's only for like sickos. So
Yeah.
it's like, why are you, what right do you have to call yourself Amityville 2, you sick movie? Don't you know normal people might go see this?
Totally.
Diane Franklin, it's like you get to see her topless, but you can't enjoy it.
No, you can't enjoy it, and then she becomes a ghost, and then she becomes like a demon or something. She's possessed. It's so weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, it takes all the enjoyment away from her beauty. I wish you'd probably mention Anne Bancroft in Lipstick. She does a great job as the to get Margot Hemingway ready for the trial, you know, and
Right, see,
how
like all
justice is not going to work out unless, you know, carry yourself a certain way. I don't know. It's just crazy.
all that coming from Mrs. Robinson.
Yeah.
Jeez. Yeah, so that's another good reason to watch Lipstick. So my number five is I Spit on Your Grave.
Okay. Yeah, you know, it took me forever to see that one because all I knew about it was a famous rape movie. And I saw the big box everywhere.
Right, and that's why it's one of the first ones I ever saw because you just couldn't escape the Wizard Video
No.
box. And it there was small boxes too. Some video stores had big box, some had small box.
Yeah, but that would just really stand out.
Right. And there's a half naked butt on the cover.
Yeah, I guess that's Demi Moore's butt.
Is it? Is that a rumor or is that true?
According to Wen Chop, there's like a whole round table where they all talk about the film, and then someone mentions that. But yes, as far as I know, Demi
Well,
Moore.
hopefully you out there, you know, listening to this can chime in. Is it Demi's board? Demi Moore, bleh.
Like Demi Moore's ass.
Demi Moore's ass.
That's a Parasite era.
Yeah, so it could be true. What else would she be doing? Master Ninja? All right, so just to reiterate, Eric's top five: Miss 45, Savage Streets, Ladies Club, Naked Vengeance, and Lipstick. For me, House on the Edge, Last House on the Left, Miss 45, Lipstick, and I Spit on Your Grave. So if you haven't seen any of those, you should get out and see them. But we're pretty sure you have if you're listening to this. But don't be a stranger. Comment. Let us know if you like this. Talk to us. I'm Skunk Ape and Eric Elham. Bleh, say your name because I can't talk anymore.
I'm Eric Hellhammer or Krankenstein.
The coffee is wearing off. Visit theaterofguts.com. Eric writes about 80% of that? I was going to say 90, but you got so many people doing reviews now, I'm dropping you down to 80%.
Okay, yeah, lately all the Deep Red guys are contributing. Graham Ray just sent me this really crazy story that was supposed to be published by Head Press, about the time him and Yorg Jarrett and John Sapunar from Xerox Ferox went to Ed Gein's gravesite and had like a crazy time.
Wow.
Yeah, and it's never been published, so he's just giving it to me, really excited.
That just sounds hilarious, 'cause what the hell do you do at his gravesite?
I know. They just
Well,
want
I
to
guess
check it out.
we're just gonna have to wait and see. So yeah, so visit Theater of Duts, Theater of Duts, Theater of Duts.
Theater of ducks.
I need more coffee. This is ridiculous.
Theaterguts.com.
Right, and the trailers that smell. Me and Eric have done multiple trailers, and as a matter of fact, you did the voice for
Mad Foxes and Ritual of Death.
Yeah, but that we're not talking about those. We're talking about Night Train Murders.
Oh yeah, Night Train Murders. How did I forget that one?
Exactly. Under the title Last Train Car on the Left, appropriately titled.
Yeah.
So go to Trailers That Smell, trailerspu.com, and theaterofguts.com. Look for this broadcast, tell your friends, and signing off. This is Skunk Ape.
And I'm A-Rock Hellhammer.